Good evening and welcome to the January edition of Bedford Common. We're here to start the new year 2013 with all kinds of good stuff, but before we get to that, I want to put out one moment of appreciation for Robert Schlechta. Bob has lived in town for 50 years and died this past week. We are all going to miss him terribly. If you did know him, you know why. If you didn't know him, think about things like the magnificent renovation of the town burying, the old historic burying ground that he and John Brown worked on for the Historical Society. Think about his time as Citizen of the Year, and think of all the other wonderful things he did for Bedford. His memorial service will be on January 27th at First Parish, and there will be more about the announcements later. So, taking a deep breath and letting you know that my typical co-host, Ron Cortez, will join me later in the program. I want to introduce our government section. We have returning Mark Siegenthaler from the Selectmen, Noreen O'Gara from the School Committee, and John Silver, who, when we were here last time, said, I have something to tell you, but I'm not going to tell you till next month. Well, John, it's next month. What's up?
Well, it's with some mixed emotions that I'm going to announce that I'm not running for re-election.
Well, dang. We're very sorry to hear that.
Yeah, I'm sorry, too. I enjoyed my time on the planning board, and I enjoyed serving with the incredible group of men and women that are on there, as well as the planning director and our new planning assistant planner. But the demands of my personal life just got to be too much, and so I'm going to let somebody else take the reins.
Well, there you go. When you've gotten a lot of important work done in these past 3 years with the comprehensive plan and bringing that all together.
That's right. And the comprehensive plan is certainly the most important thing we've worked on during my tenure, as well as bringing on Glenn Garber and Catherine Perry. And that gives me the satisfaction in knowing that the good work will carry on because we have good people in place.
Well, and we, I guess, should say that the town caucus will take place on January 8th. So if you're watching this before the 8th, we hope to see you at caucus, and you will be able to help us figure out who the candidates will be to take John's seat. Are there other things going on from the planning department?
Of course, as always.
What's up?
Well, I can't remember, quite frankly, whether I announced that we approved the Panera Express that's going down across from Mitre on
Flatbread. Quick in, quick out.
Quick in, quick out. We're excited to see that happen. In that same, most of the other developments are in that same neck of the woods. We still have a special permit amendment being filed for 100 Plank Street, which is the applicant.
The workplace?
Yeah, exactly. So he finally officially came before us. See, he had some unofficial visits trying to gauge our reaction. Danced around a bit. And then finally filed with us and so we're officially in session. In other words, we've opened it up. The hearing is open now, and I can't comment too much because it's still open. We haven't made a decision on it, but basically I can describe it, which is officially, which is 48 multifamily units and 2,000 square feet of commercial with parking and a garage, parking garages. And the general consensus of the board is that we're torn between the desire to see something happen on that property and the desire to fulfill the mixed-use bylaw that we passed in that location and making sure that that is fulfilled in the manner which it was passed so that there's something there that people can be proud of, but we haven't decided whether this project is that project yet.
Well, that's going to be something to watch for the future. Anything else going on?
Of course, yeah. So we also have a bunch of smaller administrative kinds of projects. One is, and I'm happy to say, the Blake Block is, the commercial side of it is completely rented at this point. One of the tenants is a health fitness center called Coco. It's part of a chain, and they're going to be on the bottom floor. And they've come before us for a minor amendment, basically because they were originally supposed to be on the second floor. And being on the ground floor, there were some concerns about noise and how it was going to travel to the tenants, or the, not the tenants, but the
residents upstairs
yeah. at home. In fact, right after this taping, I'm going to be meeting with the rest of the board to decide whether that's rises to the level of a major amendment, we need to revisit it, or whether we can pass it as a minor amendment with conditions.
Well, and they've got long hours.
Yeah, they've come before us for 24 hours, and we have to decide whether we're going to limit that or not, and that hasn't been decided yet. We've decided that it is a minor amendment, but that we haven't imposed any conditions on it yet. So that's what we're deciding, whether to impose conditions of hours and
Don't drop the weights between midnight and 6
o'clock. Yeah, exactly. So I think we're looking at between 5 and 11 o'clock as being acceptable, but that hasn't been decided yet. There's also an approval not required, an application for an approval not required off of Charles Street, and we have to decide whether that truly meets the definition of an approval not required. We had a legal opinion on that, and so we're going to decide that tonight as well. And then we had, probably more importantly, the special meeting with our ad hoc committee to talk about economic development portion of the comprehensive plan, and I can tell you that was a very, Mark was there and can back me up that was a very spirited discussion, and lots of great ideas came out on that, as they always are when you have a lot of public participation. So we're excited to have the draft done on that, and of course we're going to keep revising it as we go forward. So
when will the comprehensive plan be available to the community?
Well, drafts are available now.
Okay.
So they can go on the website, the town website, and they can see what we have on there today. We're happy to take their comments. In fact, we encourage any comments of people that have them on any one of the sections to call up the planning board or to write an email to the planning board. Probably better to write an email.
Yeah.
And to even come to our meetings if they want to weigh in that way. So any way they want to participate, we're more than happy to have their participation.
Outstanding. So mm-hmm. How did you like that meeting, Mark?
It was interesting, as John said. I mean, there are folks who are interested in very local economic development activities. How can we help our own immediate business community,
right,
which you all want to do, but then also ideas about how we fit into the region.
Well, the Middlesex 3.
The Middlesex 3 initiative, and just the sense that things that are positive for the whole region will be positive for Bedford, whether it happens specifically in Bedford or in neighboring communities. And so not losing sight of that, at the same time we're trying to do things to help our own local community as well.
Exactly.
There's a dynamic there, and certain activities that can happen that are best for one half of that, maybe not for the other. Hopefully it can all mesh, and the overall policy direction is supportive of both our local economy and being a part of a real vibrant region.
So Mark, what else is going on?
Well, the Selectmen have a number of things in front of us, and I think probably one of the more interesting ones is some progress on the Coast Guard housing on Pine Hill Road. A number of people have asked over the years, 2 or 3 years now, that it's been clear that it's been vacant, and people are wondering, well, so what is the Coast Guard doing? They're sitting on 16 houses that are there.
Well, and they've done new roofs, and there are lovely stainless steel chimneys coming out of them.
So for a little while, it seemed that they were, in fact, going to go back and add people back into those homes. But just recently, the Selectmen had a meeting with the Coast Guard officials, and they have now finally revealed that they are going to declare that property surplus. So that's a big step. It takes the property out of the hands of the Coast Guard and puts it into the hands of the General Services Administration, which is the federal agency responsible for disposing of property. And they have a very prescribed process they have to follow. They have to put it out for other federal agencies to determine whether there's interest there so that it could be transferred amongst federal entities. And then it works its way down through various other regional and state and possibly local agencies, depending on interest on the part of others to use those units. And there are 16 homes there that clearly could play a role for us in the town.
Well, we'll be interested to see that. Is that a sort of 2 or 3 year process, or more?
Not really clear exactly. You know, the GSA, again, will have their process. I think it's possible that it will be in their hands sometime in the middle of next year, and then they will have a whole process. We're hoping to be involved in the defining of the parameters that GSA will use. So, for example, if there's some kind of vision for what could or should happen on that property, the town would like to be able to have some input into that so that the GSA, for instance, doesn't dispose of it and possibly just allow it to be cleared and turned into something other than what
a
it
nice
is, which is a
park.
Nice little 16-unit resource.
It is a sweet set of houses.
Mm-hmm.
I was up there the other day looking around, mm-hmm. and it is a sweet set of houses, cute fences.
Little playground.
Little playground.
For the children. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, for
I mean, there are lots of ideas. There are folks who have said that you could, in fact, you could add a few more small units there, and it probably would not get overly dense for mm-hmm. most people's liking, or you could use the houses that are there. There's been a lot of discussion about downsizing for elders in town.
Mm-hmm. All one level?
All in one level.
Yeah. Co-housing mm-hmm. for families.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. There are other communities that have interesting ways in which they allow a revolving group of families to be able to occupy homes and then move on as they right. as their needs change again. So I think there's a lot of potential for creativity if you keep the faith that the federal government will allow
will
us to
faith.
Insert some creativity into that
will,
process.
We will keep the faith. We will keep the faith. So what else is happening?
Well, a few other sort of smaller things. I mean, again, also of some real interest is the Wilson Mill Dam and historic
isn't that
mill
the most
site
beautiful
construction.
Thing?
As you can see it as you drive by, it's yeah. almost complete. Of course, there's a lot of landscaping that will occur, and that'll happen in the spring when the weather obviously turns again. But the Selectmen also just voted at our meeting the other night to dedicate the bridge, which is now the bridge that used to be the dam, which isn't the dam anymore, but the reconstructed bridge will be dedicated in the memory of Gordon Feltman.
Oh, nice.
Former Selectman, who was very instrumental in getting that whole project coordinated and really working with the neighborhood and establishing the working group that's really driven all of that work over there.
Well, and when I saw the photographs, it is so beautiful.
Yeah.
How large is the pond? Does anybody have a quick idea?
I don't know.
It's an acre, couple acres.
Yeah.
Sweet little place.
It
sweet
is
little
nice.
Place.
Yeah. And I believe you had a session of your own about the sign bylaw committee. So the selectmen are anticipating some recommendations from that committee heading towards.
I've seen some drafts come through our way, and they've done a lot of good work. I can tell you that much.
It's now starting to generate some interest from outside. Nothing like having words on the page and
right.
proposed changes to have people really start to pay attention and give us a lot of advice.
Well, there
and,
you go.
We have another meeting tonight to keep working the way.
So. Then we're going to have to be expeditious and get you guys out of here in good time. Are there? You had mentioned a snow date.
Town caucus. You had mentioned town caucus, and just a reminder that if the weather's bad on the 8th, then it's scheduled again for the 9th.
All right.
Just so people can keep in mind that if
not,
looks bad and they hear that it's canceled, it'll just be one day later.
There you go. Noreen, tell us what's going on in the schools. It's been a challenging couple of just a few days, really.
Right.
We're at the very end of December.
So we had our last school committee meeting in December, and we opened with a moment of silence so that we could be reflective on what happened in Connecticut. It was, a very painful moment for everybody. And then we had Mr. Sills go forward and tell us the history of security in the schools, all of which sort of started with Columbine. It was a statewide initiative. But we were never stagnant about that. We have, always gone forward, looked at the various proposals that are around, worked very closely with Superintendents Association in the state, with our own Bedford Police and Fire Department, with our own SROs, and we're very grateful that our SROs are, funded in our budget.
Okay,
so
SROs
are our school resource officers, so they're at both the middle and the high school. So we have been on a continuum since 1999, and with a big revamp in 2009. So this gave that opportunity for us to call on all the volunteers. Our SROs stood at the doors. They were very present. We had volunteers greeting families at the schools. And we let the schools take the lead. So for our youngest students, if they're not ready to talk about it, there was no discussion. That was a family thing. And so it's really nice to have that split between the K two schools and the older kids, so you can do the developmentally appropriate thing. Mm-hmm. So that was really a wonderful thing that our community set up that way. So John's plan going forward is he's establishing a task force to start in the beginning of January. It's broad-based. We will have police, fire, our director of facilities, the principals, parent representatives from each school, school committee member. And then again, I just want to emphasize that there is support throughout the Commonwealth for this. I just received a packet from Jerry Leone, the Middlesex, you know, district attorney's office about what kind of support, what kind of programs they know about. And so that will be going on, and then we expect the school committee will get the recommendations on our February 26th. School committee meeting, but there'll be plenty of opportunity for parents to come in, that each of the principals will be holding forums, and that will be open to the parents in that school. We also hope that the Davis School could invite some of the middle preschool families who might have an interest. They know their children are coming next year, so they'll have a chance to come in and talk about that. So I'm very hopeful that we'll come to some, you know, good resolution about what should be done, what we should do next, with a lot of community input and some best practices. And this is going on in every community, I think, across the Commonwealth. I think everyone is looking and reassessing. Right.
It's the word of the day.
Absolutely. But we're lucky here because Massachusetts has taken a lot of lead on that, and they do have a lot of structures in place so that we can get information, share information, which is really important. But then we have some good news, too. So
tell
some happy,
that.
Happy news. December and January, we get a lot of early decision and early action responses from the colleges. And I really want to say our students have done wonderfully. We've gotten Yale, we've gotten Harvard, Brown, UPenn.
At least three people got into Harvard, from what I heard.
My
daughter gets the text from her friends, and
really?
She's been amazed.
Lots of good news from UMass Amherst, which had been very difficult in the last few years to get in. So we've heard lots of good news. That was an initiative we worked on last year to make sure that our process of getting our children shepherded through became easier, and that our profile was better understood by the colleges. So that's good news. But what happens in January is we also have college students come back and talk about their experience and how they applied to school. So if you're a junior or senior who haven't finished your applications, you can come in and get some information.
What a great idea.
Yeah, it's our parents do it early January. You always get a returning high school student.
Yeah.
And their parents, and they just talk about their experience. We have done that for many, many years, but the last couple of years we're also doing it as a little special program for the kids who have gone through school on an IEP or an individualized education plan, so that those kids understand that there's also a lot of resources for them, and that's been very well received. We have a special education parent association, and they have put that together. So there's a lot of really good news coming out of those kind of programs.
Outstanding.
And then we have History Night. Our juniors do History Night, which is always exciting. They have great projects. And that is on the 16th. And then finally, 16th of January. And then the Lane School has its band and orchestra concert on January 31st. So I think we'll end on a really nice high note.
Indeed we will. Now, quick question about History Night. Is that something that the public can come and hear, or is that for parents and kids?
I do think the auditorium, I do think that's the night it's open, and if you're interested, I do think you can come. I know that the kids will come to the history, the Bedford Historical Society, and present.
And I was going to say the Historical Society members would be very interested in hearing all of the programs rather than just the ones that come back as winners.
Right, those are the ones that come back as winners. The presentations are so interesting. The kids are so creative, and they're really deep thinkers.
One of the things that doesn't amaze me, but pleases me, I guess is a better word, with the Common Core and all of the things you have to focus on and that the kids have to do and the teachers have to present, there's still time for Bedford to go and dig deep and to find a project on their own and follow that path. And they do, kind of amazing stuff.
We've had performances, plays, we've had videos, we've had people writing papers that have been published. It has really been a wonderful addition to our curriculum. And the juniors worked so hard this year on that. I have to give them real kudos for putting all that time in and effort. So.
All right then.
Yeah.
So what else starts out the new year? Anybody got any hot tips for January?
tips for January.
I will say, Town Caucus, I just want to acknowledge that Ann Bickford, who's a longstanding 12-year school committee member, is stepping down. It has been my honor and pleasure to work with her, and I think we're really going to miss her, but we're looking forward to, you know, having a new colleague.
See who comes along. Mm-hmm. And Kathy Cortez, again, after 12 years, is stepping down.
Right.
So those are two phenomenally experienced servants of the town. All right, then. Our work here is done.
Thank you.
Thank you all very much for joining us. If you at home will stay put for just a couple of minutes, we have a rather special guest coming in. Her name is Sophie. She has more than 2 feet, and she lives on Concord Road. I'll bet you can guess who it is, but stay tuned to just be sure. See you in a minute.
Hi!
Hi, Bedford!
Hello, Bedford. Happy Bedford Day. Take care.
Hi, Bedford. Happy Bedford Day.
Hi, Bedford.
Hi, Bedford.
Bedford Day's awesome.
Woo!
Hi, Bedford.
And we're back. Our guests in this segment are Ann Keissling and Steve Hagan, who are the proprietors of Bedford's newest adventure, a goat-based micro-dairy and goat farm out on Concord Road. Ann, Steve, thank you so much for joining us. And our major guest here, they're just here to bring Sophie. Sophie is a doling. That means that she is young.
Mm-hmm.
And so would you tell us about her, a little bit about her?
So Sophie is sort of an experiment. There are major goat dairy breeds are the big white Swiss goats.
And that's what you have mostly?
That's what we have mostly. And then there is a breed that was developed in California and Mexico to give milk for a longer period of time. And Sophie is half of each. So she's half Saanen and half La Mancha.
All right, and that means that Sophie will be around for a long time and producing good milk for you?
We hope so. We hope she'll produce lots of milk for 2 years.
A regular goat doesn't quite last that long?
That's right. A regular goat needs to be bred about every year. They have to have a baby to keep milking, just like cows.
Okay.
But occasionally a goat can go longer. We have a couple of goats that are still milking.
Outstanding. How many goats are there altogether, Steve? Oh, I'm sorry.
We have...
So
11.
You don't have to name them.
No, 11 altogether.
It's like grandchildren, right?
There's 10 females and one male whose only job is to wander around and guard the perimeter.
And he's called a wether.
A wether.
Wether.
He's not, it's a tough subject for that. I had to get this question. He's not a complete male anymore. Otherwise, he'd be called a buck.
All right.
So he is a buck, missing a couple of parts.
All right.
And but he's good. He still is out there, and he looks after the, you know, protecting the females in the
and
pasture.
He's cute as all get out. What is his name?
Bobby.
But of course, why wouldn't I have thought that?
I thought that that would be his
what
name.
What happened to Billy? Well, no, I was just asking.
Yeah. We've never had a Billy, I don't think.
No.
Okay.
Bobby's our only one, you know, since you've been around.
Well, there you go. And they, good for you for not caving to tradition.
Right. Right. Yeah.
Oh, going I guess with Billy Goat's Gruff, right?
Yeah.
Right,
I think we've never had a Billy Goat's
Gruff. So, quick question. Now, how did you, this is not new to you, although it is new in Bedford.
Well, no, we've had goats in Bedford since 1989.
Well, but not doing things like this.
She's eating my microphone.
No. The goats that we've had in Bedford for all these years were a 4-H project.
Okay.
So the girls bred the goats, but we never did any kind of marketing or any. So we had to our barn wouldn't manage it, so we had to build a new barn.
Well, it's quite a spectacular barn. We had the opportunity. We had the opportunity to visit your barn during your open house, and it is just beautiful. It smells wonderful when you walk in, and it just. All this beautiful sawdust on the floor and clean as a whistle and these beautiful gates that change one pen into another size. Who helped you design that?
I think 30 years of having goats is what designed it. I think that's probably what did it.
Okay. And so you have goats now because in such a...
Well, because I really feel very strongly that the goat milk and goat milk products are misunderstood.
Tell me more.
Most of the world drinks goat milk, but not in this country. In this country, we're used to cow's milk. And cow's milk and microdairies are great projects, but they're very difficult to have in an urban setting. You're not going to have a cow dairy in the middle of Bedford because of all kinds of, the animals are large, the manure is very difficult to deal with.
Health regulations.
Health regulations, right. Zoning regulations. But you can have, obviously, you can have dairy goats. And these animals produce, when she gets full grown, she'll produce a gallon of milk a day.
Whoa.
So that is enough with we have 4 or 5 gallons of milk a day now that we can use to pasteurize and to make cheese. And obviously it can be done in the middle of a town.
Well, and it was amazing to me to see the machinery that you have. It's very real. You might think that you were in the hood dairy, except in a miniature form. I mean, you've got all of the pasteurization products or machines, and how long does it take to go from the goat until to something like this?
To pasteurize takes, you have to heat it up to a certain temperature, and we're using an old-fashioned pasteurization method that's very low temperature. So the idea
is... Is that better for the flavor?
It's better for the flavor. It doesn't have quite as long a shelf life as the ultra-high pasteurized milks that you can buy that stay on the shelf at room temperature, for instance. This is an older fashioned. It's heated to a temperature that was designed just to kill tuberculosis. It wasn't designed to kill any of the good nutrition of milk.
Well,
only do that in kind of small scale.
Okay.
Right?
And if you can get a close-up of this, I'm going to put it down so it doesn't jiggle. This is the Bedford Blueberry Goat Farm milk. It is available in several markets.
Right. It's available at Chippin Farm.
Yeah.
Wilson Farm. Deborah's Natural Gourmet in Concord.
Yeah.
And in an Allendale Farm in Brookline.
Wow. How does Allendale come out and pick it up, or do you?
No, we take it there.
Okay. Well, that's kind of a good ride. It's in an awful pretty place.
Yeah. Yeah. We've known that the person who farms Allendale Farm lives in Carlisle.
I was just going to say he's kind of local to us.
Yeah.
And then goat cheese. Now this is...
So that's a
fromage blanc.
And that's a fresh cheese. It's not an aged cheese. So that's a fresh... It's not in any kind of competition with the wonderful aged goat cheeses that you can buy. A very fresh cheese.
And it has maybe...
That has cranberries in it.
Ready for the holidays.
Right.
How marvelous. So the next question is, I've never tasted goat's milk. May I open this and give it a
yes,
try?
Yes, absolutely. You should pass it around.
We shall.
Much of that was produced by Sophie's mother.
Well, all right. Well, it looks like milk. It smells like milk. It tastes like cream.
It's good, isn't it?
Oh my, yes. Well,
we make a...
Talk among yourselves.
It's a little richer than
milk. We make a vanilla-flavored sweetened coffee creamer that's really good.
Oh, that's gorgeous.
I should have brought you some.
Absolutely gorgeous. So, Bedford, we have many things to be very proud of, and now we have the Bedford Blueberry Goat Farm. One of the things you told me during the... open house, Steve, is why it's called the Bedford Blueberry Goat Farm.
I did? Good
something,
for me.
Something about Mrs. Barron and that the trees...
The blueberries.
Oh, that used to be what the land that it's on used to be, a blueberry patch. It was on... Mrs. Barron lived across the street of Barron's garage. She was there so long, she knew when that was actually farmed as blueberries. It was a commercial blueberry patch.
And now,
so you can still find the blueberries out in the woods.
The occasional blueberry.
Yeah. Well, there's lots of plants. We just got to trim them and get them back to going again. She has found more things to chew on.
No, I was going to say he should get a shot of her eating the paper
towels. Oh, yeah. She's busy eating the paper towels.
Eating the paper towels.
Well, now, this brings up something that I grew up, kept as an article of faith, that goats eat tin cans. And I was damn sore vexed, to tell you the gospel truth, when I heard that they didn't. What is behind that legend that goats eat tin cans?
They eat the label.
The label has good tasting glue on it, to a goat, you know.
Yes, okay.
And so they happily eat the label off the can. And that's why they got the pictures. The famous ones are all from World War II on the Pacific Islands when our Marines were there and the natives had goats, yeah. And that the Marines ate out of cans. And the goats happily ate all the labels off. And that's where the famous pictures came from.
Like she's happily eating this paper towel.
Yeah, that, right, right.
Well, paper is that all right? I mean, is she going to be all right with it?
Yeah,
it's fine.
Paper's
fine. I mean, trees are their favorite food.
Well, now, yeah. Sometimes when I'm in traffic and right. watching down, looking down into the farm, you'll see this cluster of white, and they're up, and they're chomping around, and they're standing on rocks, and then you also have a path to get them to a larger pasture. Can you tell me right. a little bit about that?
Yes, they actually go through about an 8-foot buffer zone through a wetland to get over to their main pasture.
But it
so
isn't
they
just
do
walking
that on the
on
rocks.
The...
No, they have to. They walk over there on the rock on a rock wall.
They love.
They have a rock
goats.
Wall that goes over yeah. to their pasture.
Goats but
they
love have probably walking on a, rocks.
What yeah. is it? A half acre pasture over there?
Oh, or at least an acre yeah. probably.
A place to you gamble. Know,
it's
and
an
roam.
Acre and it can grow, mm-hmm. so they all can run.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Whoops.
Whoa.
Hey. Ah. She says,
"Go, Sophie.
Those are worth my paper towels. They're rolling away."
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
What else would you like Bedford to know about Bedford's Blueberry Goat Farm?
I guess that we hope it becomes a community resource. We oh, like to have
right.
people know that they're welcome to visit.
School children groups, you know, with a teacher or somebody. Yeah, yeah, and 4-H clubs. We attended this, you know, where it's that's why they're out where you can see them from the street instead of the other direction, so people can notice. There may be a group, in fact, coming tomorrow morning, you know, from another school you know, over in Belrica.
Outstanding.
Yeah, so this is all available for them. They're all welcome. And as you can see, they're very curious and very tame.
Well,
you,
and
you
very
think
sweet
of Billy
temper.
Goat Gruff, but they're really very mild and very almost, don't yell at them, they'll run away. They're quite mild-mannered. Right?
Well, there I would say
you'll even
tempered.
Put up with me, won't you? Yeah, right.
I would say sweet-tempered.
Yes. Yeah.
Well, Sophie, it has been an absolute delight to meet you. Are you getting a good portrait going there so the world
yeah.
can see Sophie?
She's saying, "Yeah, hey, come around here. This is my good side over here. If you get this side, you know, that's where I part my fur, and that's where it all works out."
There you go.
I think mean goats got eaten.
It's entirely possible.
Yeah, bad behaved goats.
2,000 years ago. Yeah.
They became dinner first, and the good behaved ones were kept around.
Well, all I can tell you is that I'm going to, now the cheese is available at Chip-In as well?
Yes.
Yes.
I will be at Chip-In shortly, well, maybe not tonight, first thing tomorrow morning to acquire some of this cranberry cream from on.
Well, that's for you guys to keep and try here.
All right.
Yeah.
It is a fine thing. Thank you very much.
Yes, you should try that. Pass that around.
We shall do. And thank you both very much for coming and being with us on Bedford Common. Ann Keissling and Steve Hagan of Bedford's Blueberry Goat Farm. And we're not going to forget Sophie. Sophie is
right.
the main attraction. Thanks for being with us. We'll be right back with a visitor from Hanscom Field. Colonel Weilacher is going to be with us. So what can we tell you except please stay with us.
Hey, Bedford. Oi, Bedford. Tudo bem?
É, brasileiro no Bedford.
Bedford TV. Yay. Happy Bedford Day.
Hi there.
Yo, Bedford, what's up?
Happy Bedford Day.
Hey, I'm Officer Maloney from the Bedford Police Department, wishing everybody a happy Bedford Day.
Hi!
Hello, Bedford! Happy Bedford Day! Yay.
Happy Bedford Day!
Happy Bedford Day!
We're back.
Well, I'm not back. I'm here for the first time, and I want to apologize to Julie and to all of you folks for missing the first part of the show, but such are family schedules that one cannot avoid. But here I am.
We're delighted to have you. Our guest in this particular part of Bedford Common for January 2013 is none other than Colonel J.R. Weilacher, who is the big cheese over at Hanscom Field. I'm not sure. Well, that's because I'm not exactly sure what your title is, Colonel.
Oh, that's fair. I am the commander of the 66th Air Base Group and the installation commander at Hanscom.
In other words, the big cheese. That is a big title.
It's a big title. It's a big job. But I think it's important to realize that at Hanscom, we still have a three-star general who is the big cheese, my boss.
Okay, so you're a medium-sized cheese?
A medium cheese. He is Lieutenant General Moore. He is commander of the Air Force Lifecycle Management Center. He is headquartered at Wright-Patterson Air Force Base. But he is with us at Hanscom frequently and provides a great deal of direction for us as we support the warfighter in the United States Air Force.
So this is a big change for Hanscom. I mean, there used to be a three-star lieutenant general in residence, and then a major general, a two-star, and now we're evolving through yet another change. And I know there's a lot of people in town who aren't quite sure what's going on and what the future holds. And
sure.
Can you enlighten that a little bit for us?
Yeah, absolutely. We're really excited about the change. Back in the June time frame, the Air Force Materiel Command, one of the major commands in the United States Air Force, announced that we would be shifting from what was called a 12-center construct down to a 5-center construct. And the bottom line there is we did that to streamline processes and obtain efficiencies in the way we do business. So before, Hanscom, the Aeronautical Center, the Aeronautical Systems Division at Wright-Patt, or the Aeronautical Systems Center at Wright-Patt. And then we had the Air Armament Center down at Eglin, for example, where there was a resident, say, three-star general. And what we had were what we call cylinders of excellence. And what the five-center construct has allowed us to do is we've taken down some of those barriers to cross-communication across all of the program executive officers that are responsible for acquiring and providing product support for Air Force weapon systems.
Well, do the advances in technology in the last, say, 10 or 12 years, particularly with the social media, with computers, with the internet, the cloud, Wi-Fi, does that help you? I'm guessing that it does. I don't want to put words in your mouth.
No, certainly. I mean, there's obviously a lot we can do via video teleconferencing, and that's another way that we try to save money from having to travel TDY back and forth. But yeah, I would say that social media has helped as well.
Well, I mean, not that we're going to find out what's happening in the world on your Facebook page, but the idea of so much interaction and communication back and forth and the ease of communication now between disparate parts of...
Yeah, certainly. And I know large corporations have figured out how to make this work in the private world, and we really don't see this as anything different. And again, you know, General Moore is here at Hanscom frequently and is still very involved in the work that's done here. A lot of people say, hey, you lost the three-star. Well, no, we really gained a different three-star.
Well, there you go.
Right,
so now, what's going on at Hanscom these days? I mean, they took so much of the military housing away at the corner, there were a lot of mobile homes.
Oh, the mobile home park.
And that seems to me that if those go, that means military personnel are somewhere else. And so how many people are at Hanscom now?
Well, I would say that the direct jobs created by Hanscom is in excess of 5,500 jobs. And the indirect jobs created by Hanscom is of over 14,500. It's interesting you bring up the mobile home park that we used to have. We are blessed with 730 privatized housing units at Hanscom. We have about 2,600 folks that live in them, and the development is at 100% occupancy. So we have a thriving privatized housing community on Hanscom.
And so much nicer than living in a house trailer.
Trailers have their place, but these are beautiful homes.
Oh, outstanding. So, if someone is in the Air Force, what makes them choose Hanscom as a place for their next assignment?
Well, if you're like me, you found out that you were coming to Hanscom, and quite honestly, not being familiar with the Northeast, I had to look it up on a map to see where Hanscom was.
But now you know.
And now I know. But what I would tell anybody that finds out that they're coming to Hanscom is to get ready, because the community support and the support for the military that I've experienced here is really unparalleled of any of the other 10 locations I've lived in my 23 Air Force career.
We're very proud of Hanscom Air Force Base. We're very very happy to have the people there as members of our community. Certainly we're very proud to have the high school students as part of Bedford High School. It's frankly, it's a financial burden on the town because the government does not reimburse us anywhere near what it costs us to educate them. But we wouldn't give it up for anything. It's just a wonderful enrichment to the town to have you folks here.
A window on the world we wouldn't otherwise have.
Well, I thank you for that. And Bedford High in particular has been extremely gracious. We have a dedicated counselor that works with the children that are coming to Hanscom and attend school at Bedford High School. And I've had an opportunity to meet with the superintendent and the principal, Mr. Henry Turner, and we have a very strong working relationship, and we're very, very happy for the opportunity for our children to attend Bedford High.
What kind of, oh, I'm sorry.
That's all right. No, I was gonna say, you mentioned the number of places you've been before, which actually, I was remiss at the beginning of this segment, because mostly this segment's to introduce you to the townspeople.
Sure.
So, why don't you tell us a little about yourself? Where are you from? How'd you get into the Air Force? A little bit about who you are.
Sure. I'm third generation military. My grandfather served in the Navy during World War II on a heavy cruiser and participated in action at Iwo Jima. Mm. My father is a retired lieutenant colonel from the Air Force. He was a fighter pilot and did two tours in Vietnam. And it's just military service, you could say, is the family business, and it's something that I knew I was very interested in pursuing. My dad's last duty assignment was Holloman Air Force Base in Alamogordo, New Mexico. That's where I grew up, and I went to school at New Mexico State University and joined the Air Force through the Air Force Reserve Officer Training Corps, and have enjoyed a fantastic 23 years in the service of our country in the Air Force.
Congratulations.
Thank you very much.
What was your primary mission in the Air Force? I mean, were you in research? Were you a pilot?
By training, I am a financial manager. I've had assignments at just about every level of the business in the Air Force, from the squadron to the wing to the center to the major command, the air staff working in the Pentagon, and then ultimately in the Office of the Secretary of Defense for Comptroller right before coming to Hanscom Air Force Base. So, yeah, financial manager by training.
Excellent.
Well, we're mighty lucky to have you here.
It's a great time to have that skill set.
Especially with what may hopefully not happen.
Exactly.
We're not going there. And the world may end tomorrow. This is the day before the Mayan calendar ends.
Oh, that's right.
This whole thing's maybe up
to grabs. I suspect if the Mayans were so good at telling what was going to happen in the future, there would still be Mayans.
That was in the newspaper this morning. So now you know when we are. Colonel Weilacher, what kinds of things are going on at Hanscom now? I mean, in terms of work and the people that are there. I know you've just opened a new command.
Right. And I'd like to go back to the five-center construct as well. When we went to obtain these efficiencies and processes, the core functions at Hanscom Air Force Base were unaffected. So in other words, the capability, the work that we do to acquire war-winning capabilities hasn't changed in the slightest. And when we went from the 12-center construct down to the 5-center construct, the positions that were eliminated were primarily overhead and administrative type positions. So it's important for the people in Bedford and the surrounding communities to know the core functions of Hanscom have not changed.
And that would be the research and development kinds of things?
Absolutely. Our support and our relationships with the federally funded research and development centers, the MIT Lincoln Laboratories, MITRE. So those things are still very much, very much going on.
Does AFCRL still? Oh, AFCRL.
The Air Force Research Laboratories.
Yeah.
I support them as a I'm their support unit. They're geographically separated from us down in New York. But no, the Air Force Research Laboratory is no longer on Hanscom.
Okay. That was one of the things that brought us to Bedford.
Sure. And now you mentioned the Joint Force Headquarters. Last week we had a fantastic ceremony out at the base where we welcomed the Joint Force Headquarters for the Massachusetts National Guard onto Hanscom Air Force Base. When completed, they're roughly $50 million facility will house well over 400 guardsmen at full strength. The governor of Massachusetts, Governor Patrick, the lieutenant governor, Lieutenant Governor Murray, Senator-elect Warren.
We heard it was a pretty good party.
And we had a member of the Joint Chiefs of Staff with us as well. So
Whoa.
It was an incredible ceremony, and it was a pleasure to be a part of that as we dedicated this brand new facility so that they can better support the state of Massachusetts in their federal missions
and
as well.
And so this is an all-new building that they're
it's
in?
It's a brand new facility. Now, the first phase is open. The second phase should open in the spring.
Well, I think we need to get on the list for that party.
Sounds good to me.
I would like to be, just in case you're wondering.
You're welcome to come out anytime. I'm sure the new Adjutant General of the Massachusetts National Guard, Major General Rice, would be happy to have you and give
and
you a tour.
And we'd be happy to have Major General Rice come and talk to us about what it means to be in Bedford for the Massachusetts National Guard.
I'm sure he'd be willing to do that.
So what other kinds of things? There are families on Hanscom. Are many of them deployed? Are they...
Yeah, especially at this time of year, we always want to think about our deployed families. Between Hanscom Air Force Base proper and the units that we support, we have about 90 folks downrange at this time of year. It's also kind of neat that we have some homecomings. In fact, my deputy got into Baltimore today. And he is
okay.
trying to get back home before the holidays, and I think he was ending up renting a car and driving here
today. That might be the best way to wish him that's going to happen.
Yeah, now he was down in Oman helping get ready for the retrograde of equipment out of Afghanistan, and we'll be very happy to have him back.
So does that mean Hanscom will get involved in some of those things, or is this just his personal mission?
That was his mission while he was deployed in Oman, yes.
Okay. So... how many families at Hanscom are there altogether these days? I mean, is there a vibrant community, or are you...
It's an exceptionally vibrant community. Again, we have about 732 housing units for our members, and primarily those are for families.
Okay.
And we are at 100% occupancy with about 2,600 folks living in our base housing. What's interesting about our housing community is you think it's an Air Force base that our residents would be Air Force, and that's partially true. About 50% of our residents are Air Force, but we also house members of our sister services. So we do have soldiers, sailors, and Coast Guardsmen, and Marines living in Hanscom Air Force Base housing as well. So we're a really neat joint community. And the way I described it is, you know, despite our service rivalries, when we go downrange or we sit around a barbecue in housing, we get along pretty well.
Well, and what a wonderful way to share. I don't know. I'm big on people who don't know one another very well getting to know one another
right.
better. And what better way to do it than over a beer and a barbecue? Well, maybe not a beer. Who knows about the beer part? But certainly over the barbecue part.
Certainly.
I go for the beer and the barbecue.
Well, that's
no
all right.
Problem.
I probably would too, come to think of it. So what would you and the families and the people who are working at Hanscom like Bedford to know about you?
I love being here in the New England
area. You and the community.
Me and the community.
Yeah. I did nothing like a tough question.
I think I would like them to know that we're grateful for the services that Bedford provides the men and women of Hanscom Air Force Base. Again, our children play soccer together. Our children go to school together. We attend worship services together. And we're thankful for the great reception and the hospitality shown to all of us that may be perhaps in the New England area for the first time.
Well, we're, as Ron said, we're mighty glad to have you.
We certainly are, and we're mighty glad to have you on the show. Thank you so much for coming on.
It's been my pleasure, sir.
We do this every time your position changes.
Which is about every 2 years.
yes.
But maybe you'll re-up. Maybe you'll find a way to stay.
Maybe they'll find a way for me to stay.
It has happened.
It has.
There are some people who have retired and come back to Bedford.
One of the most interesting things I have is when we go to various community functions, the number of people that approach me and say, I had your job. So I know that you do retain quite a few of our folks.
There you go. Well, we're delighted, and Happy New Year.
Thank you so very much. Happy holidays to you. Happy holidays
to you,
sir. Thank you.
Thanks for coming on. So stay with us. We will, or at least I will, be right back.
Goodbye, Bedford. Happy New Year.
Hey, Bedford, how you doing?
Hi, Bedford. I love Bedford Day.
Hi. Hi, Bedford.
Hi, Bedford.
Hello, Bedford. I'm Alex.
Hello, Bedford. Shalom uvracha.
Friends, in the 5 years since we've done this show, I've never used this platform to editorialize. Tonight I'm going to make an exception. We're taping this less than a week after the horrible slaughter of children in Newtown, Connecticut. And as a grandfather and a father, I just can't get it out of my mind. And so I need to speak my mind. My friends, we all need to come together to figure out what has gone so terribly wrong with this country that allows us to witness things like Columbine and Aurora and Tucson and Virginia Tech and just shrug them off and go on about our daily lives. These events each were terrible. But Newtown was different. These were innocent little children that were murdered. Yes, it happens on the streets of our cities every day. But Newtown was different. Newtown was intolerable. We, all of us, you and I, need to work together to figure out how this unspeakably horrible thing happened, and to say to ourselves with firm resolve, never again. We as a nation need to come to terms with the realities of what America has become. We all need to work together to find a broadly acceptable middle ground between those who would just abolish the Second Amendment and those who believe in the completely unfettered right to own military-style weapons. And of course, that's only part of the problem, but it is part of the problem, and the very soul of our nature depends on it. So I ask you tonight, my friends, look in your hearts, examine your consciences. If you pray, pray for guidance. And then do something about it. Talk to your friends and neighbors. Find organizations that support your beliefs and work with them. Pressure our elected leaders to, you know, lead. And then keep pressuring until they do lead. We have to stop this madness before it consumes all of us. Because the next time, it could happen in Bedford. It could happen to someone you love. My friends, I'm not going to wish you a happy new year. I think, given what has happened, that would be a folly. I will wish all of you and all of us a better new year and a better future than the one that we've already carved out for ourselves. Never again. Good night, Bedford.